Hey everyone, thanks for watching 3dmotive.com. This is Donald, and in this tutorial we'll be using 3ds Max 2010 and taking a look at creating collision for use inside of UDK. Now this tutorial assumes that you already understand the basics of object creation in 3ds Max, as well as importing content into UDK. Now to begin with, let's clarify exactly what collision is and why it's important. For this mesh that I have here, let's assume that we're using it for a game where you're a normal human player and this is a third-person style game. You know, maybe you'll see this object as you're running down a castle street or something in some sort of a medieval setting. Now, this object that I have here is made up of a few thousand triangles. Regardless of the amount of polygons you've used to create your mesh, when building collision, the goal is to create a much lower polygon object that will encompass the game mesh that you actually see. And so, for example, if I go ahead and unhide the collision example that I've created, and I'll be showing you a little bit more information about this later, this object would be invisible to the player and have a lot lower polygon count, therefore being much less costly to calculate collision for inside of the game engine. Now imagine for a moment that your player would actually be running around on the street, bumping into this very simple vendor stand. If every single one of the polygons of this object were calculated, and let's say you had hundreds more of these meshes inside of your game would basically crawl to a halt trying to process that much information. So as game artists, our goal is to create a much simpler mesh that is calculated instead. Now if you've ever played a game and you've gotten hung up or stuck in that corner while the zombies are eating your face, you know exactly about the importance of creating good collision. Now when working in UDK, as long as you name your collision mesh correctly and follow a few basic rules, this invisible collision mesh will be exported alongside of your regular game mesh when you bring it into the engine. Now before I show you the export process, let's look at a couple basic rules and examples of what you can and can't get away with when building the collision meshes. Now the green meshes that I have here represent good collision, and basically what Unreal will accept without too much issues. Some of these simple primitives like boxes, cylinders, and spheres are pretty much perfect examples of what good clean collision meshes will look like. The basic rule of thumb is that solid convex shapes are ideal, and solid concave shapes are bad. Now, if you're like me and you haven't had a geometry class in a while, the best way that I remember it is that concave meshes cave in. And so the reason to avoid this is that when using UDK, it will automatically attempt to fill the gaps between any of these concave shapes. And so, for example, some of the shapes that I have here, this awkward box shape and this abstract sort of cylindrical shape, if I kind of rotate the camera around a little bit, you can see that if you follow along the path, you'll notice that the geometry tends to kind of dip inward and basically cave into itself. A smarter way of building them is here next to the objects here that are represented by the green shapes, would basically mean to go ahead and break this up into multiple pieces that still give you the silhouette that you want and the boundary that you're looking for the collision, and basically keeping this object in two separate pieces rather than trying to make one solid mass that has this concave shape that we want to look out for. And so these green shapes here would be acceptable, and the exact same thing over here on this side with this green shape compared to this red one here. Now another example would be here on the end. I have these sort of crisscross looking shapes that I have here. And so if I go ahead and look at it from the top view, you'll notice that if this is a solid mesh, the silhouette of this is going to follow right along these boundary points, which essentially means that this is in fact a concave mesh. And so a smarter way of doing that is rather than, you know, trying to make this a solid mass and extruding out these edges, is to just go ahead and make two boxes as separate objects, and that'll still go ahead and maintain that silhouette that we're looking for. And so these are just a few of the very, very basic rules of generating collision. One of the easiest things that you could do is just really try to encompass your mesh as best as possible, you know, using nothing but boxes. Try to keep the polygon count as low as possible as well, simply because the more complex your collision gets, obviously the more accurate it's going to be, but also ultimately it's going to become more expensive as well. And so if I go ahead and hide this and bring up my original collision example, you'll notice that when we saw our original stand, this is really all that I did was, you know, I just kind of took some of those basic principles that I showed you. I went in and I just created a bunch of random boxes and tried to adhere to the fact that, you know, even for something a little bit more customized like this shape here, you know, if I wanted to have like a slight little ramp where the player could walk up to it, you know, as long as I'm avoiding those concave shapes, this should suffice just fine. For, you know, the actual in-game asset. You know, it doesn't need to get too much more complex than this. What I have here, this would be plenty sufficient enough for a third-person game. Now, another thing to think about, too, is if I was, you know, a giant robot walking around in this level, and this object was actually fairly small, The collision could literally just be like a simple little box, you know, around the main frame of the stand here, and then you know, maybe just one other little box here for the, you know, the little stool that we've got here. And then if I wanted to get really complex, like let's say that my game was actually taking place as a mouse and I was running around on this actual platform, obviously then we would need to go in and really try to make the collision as close as possible. So you'll have to kind of use your best judgment, and it's kind of a case-by-case basis depending on what the setting is for your actual game and how your collision is going to ultimately be used in the type of game that you're making. But for now, for our third-person style game, this should do just fine. And so to start with, to go ahead and get this object ready to import into UDK, I'm going to go ahead and start by hiding our actual prop and make sure that I'm showing, you know, just our collision meshes for now. What we want to do first is I'm going to go ahead and close the layers, and I'm going to grab all of my objects. I want to make sure that everything is an editable poly by right-click, convert to editable poly. I'm going to go ahead and grab any one of the random boxes, any of the pieces or parts of our object. And I'm going to go ahead and use the attach function by clicking on the dialog box here. And when that pops up over here, I'm just going to go ahead and select all and hit attach. And so that's going to make sure that I attach all of my meshes together. And you want to make sure that, you know, you just have one single mesh that's going to be used for your collision object. Now, another rule that I didn't mention earlier, and that is if I go ahead and bring up the object properties here and turn the visibility back off, you'll notice that I don't have any open faces. You really want to try to avoid that. And by open faces, what I mean is, for example, if I grab the bottom of these and just deleted them out, and I had an open edge or border here, you really want to try to avoid that. You won't be able to bring it in. You could possibly get some errors on import. So really, really do your best to make sure that everything is a complete closed mesh. And so now that our collision is a single object, I want to go ahead and reset the transforms. And I'll do that over here under the Utilities tab, under Reset X Form. Go ahead and click Reset Selected. And then back inside of the Modify panel, you can always just right-click Convert to Editable Poly. And so now that our mesh is pretty much ready, I'm going to go ahead and open up the original vendor prop here. And if I go ahead and select it, right now I've got the visibility turned back off, but if I toggle wireframe, you can see it underneath of there. And so what I want to do is I'm going to go ahead and copy the actual name of the prop that I'm wanting to export. And then I'm going to select the collision mesh. And what we need to do is we need to put a specific name at the very beginning of this mesh so that when it exports out of 3ds Max and comes into UDK, it recognizes it basically as the collision mesh. And so the way that we do that is we go ahead and type in UCX underscore, and then we want to go ahead and paste the original name of our asset that we copied a little bit earlier. Now, this UCX extension is basically, it's what it stands for is Unreal Convex Collision. And it's sort of the basic catch-all for the majority of the collision types that you will be creating. Now, there are a couple other extensions if you were creating just a simple box. For example, the name for that would be UBX. And then if you were creating something that was just a sphere, you could use USP. But under all of these circumstances, UCX will generally catch pretty much any sort of collision that you can create. And then when you go ahead and export this from 3ds Max, Unreal will recognize this as the specific collision mesh that you created. Now, the last thing that we need to do is line up the pivot point so that the pivot point of the collision lines up exactly the same as the pivot point for our street vendor prop. And so if I go ahead and select a street vendor prop, and look at the pivot point of it, and go ahead and turn the grid on. It looks like it's set to 0, 0, but just to be safe, in case your object is out somewhere else, let's go ahead and select the collision mesh, and then I'm going to go ahead and center to object, and hit reset transform on that. And then what I want to do is I'm going to go ahead and use the align tool, and using the align tool up here, after selecting this, is I'm going to go ahead and select just a little tiny piece of our original vendor prop, and by clicking on this, this is going to tell it to, hey, you know, let's align this pivot point with another target object's pivot point. So you want to make sure that you have XYZ selected and you have pivot point on both of the objects. If it's center, minimum, or anything else, it's not going to work correctly. So make sure you set that pivot point, XYZ, and that's saying, hey, you know, align the collision mesh's pivot point to the selected object pivot point, which is our original prop. And so go ahead and hit OK. And then we can go ahead and get out of effect pivot only by selecting deselecting the button object. And so if we go ahead and pull our camera back, I think this mesh is pretty much ready to go. We'll go ahead and export this into UDK just like we normally would a regular static mesh without a collision mesh on it. So once you've actually brought your object here into UDK, the easiest way to check for the collision is to go ahead and select this little button, green button here with the red circle around it. This will go ahead and toggle the collision on and off visually so you can see what the collision looks like. And then also right here, you'll notice the number of primitives. And so as you're creating your collision mesh, if you want to kind of make sure that this number here matches up with the number that you have back in 3ds Max, that'll help you to make sure that that it imported correctly and that you didn't have any concave meshes in which UDK, auto-generated some of those meshes, which you probably didn't want. And so that's a quick way to kind of check for that sort of stuff. Now, you'll also notice under the collision window, there are several other options. And what these are is these are auto-generated collision that UDK can create for your mesh. Now, these aren't going to be nearly as good as if you had actually sat down and created the mesh yourself, but you can play around with them. And what they'll do is they'll basically try to find the boundary points of your static mesh and create an automatic collision from there. And so, for example, if I go to the 6DOP simplified collision, this is going to actually create a very simple box mesh that's going to encompass our entire object, but still only have the basic six sides that a square would. And so, back at our giant robot example, a collision like this may actually work just fine, and then we wouldn't need to worry about trying to export it out of 3ds Max. And if I wanted to try to get a little bit more complex under collision, all the way down to the 26DOP simplified, this is actually going to create a mesh that's essentially got a lot more vertices, and it is going to try to wrap the main outer silhouette of the object as best as possible, but still only maintaining one solid mass, as you can see with our number of primitives is still set to 1. And so if I wanted to get something just a little bit more complex under collision, I could go into auto convex collision. And this will actually bring up a dialog box, which will allow you to adjust some of the sliders, which will determine just how complex or how simplistic this automated collision is going to be. And so if I hit apply, one thing that you'll also notice is that it actually is going to create a couple different pieces, which is going to be a lot better than those simple boxes. This is going to be a little bit accurate, but in the long run, it's still not going to be quite as perfect as if you manually go in there and generate the collision for yourself. Now, one last thing that you can do is if you're not happy with the collision that UDK has created for you, you can get rid of the collision by clicking on Collision, Remove Collision, and this will give you a dialog pop-up that asks you, hey, are you sure you want to remove it? If you go ahead and click yes, that'll go ahead and wipe out the actual collision, whether it's the collision that you created or the collision that UDK created, the collision is no longer there. And so from here, I would physically need to go back and re-import the static mesh to get my collision back for me. Now, if I right-click on my static mesh and hit re-import static mesh, this actually won't bring in the collision with it correctly. UDK is going to treat this as a new object now that you've wiped out the collision. And so if you just go ahead and import the object just like you normally would when you first started, this will accurately bring in the collision mesh that we originally had created. So that about wraps up the basics of using 3ds Max to create collision for your objects in UDK. Feel free to play around with any of the shapes or custom tools that we've talked a little bit about. I hope you've enjoyed this tutorial, and thanks again for watching 3dmotive.com.